work from home scenario. And we have been joined by two very eminent speakers for today's webinar. Honorable Justice Madan Lokur, who is the former judge of Supreme Court of India. He's the former judge of Supreme Court of India. His contribution to the Indian judiciary, ICT enablement of courts, judicial education, legal aid services, juvenile justice, and ADR is unparalleled. As the judge in charge of the E-Committee of the Supreme Court of India, he spearheaded the E-Courts project to enhance the efficiency in the justice delivery system in India. The E-Courts filing procedure is currently available for use by 18,000 plus district courts and 21 high courts. Honorable Justice Lokur currently serves as a judge of the non-resident panel of the Supreme Court of Fiji. Thank you so much, Justice Lokur, for joining us. It's
By the way, James.
We also have Dr. Karnika Seth, who is a cyber law expert and founding partner of Seth Associates. She is an internationally renowned cyber law, IP and media laws expert, practicing in the Supreme Court of India and High Court of Delhi. She is an accomplished author, policy maker, and educator on cyber laws. Dr. Seth is the founder of Seth Associates, an established law firm based in Delhi that renders legal services to both domestic and global clients for more than two decades. She is the founder of a not-for-profit organization called FIRE, which is Foundation for Institutional Reforms and Education, working to spread cyber awareness in India. Thank you so much, Dr. Seth, for joining us. And as we all know that in current scenario, we all are working from home, and it's a challenging time and very difficult to sort of integrate with our all datas which are currently available in our sort of a hard drive. But despite that, a lot of data is available on cloud, which we are currently connected to. So what happens is, while there is an ease of accessing that data and working from home in a remote environment, simultaneously there is a challenge. We are exposed to a lot of risks, online risk, and we become vulnerable to a lot of cyber crime. So considering that, this becomes a very timely and apt topic which we thought Fiki would take up. And I once again thank Dr. Seth and Justice Lokur to kindly agreeing to join us for this particular webinar. So I won't take much time, and I request Dr. Seth to make her technical presentation. And post that, we will request Justice Lokur to deliver his special address. So may I request Dr. Seth to kindly start your presentation. Thank you.
I hope you are able to see the screen. In the beginning. Is it all clear, the screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So at the outset, I thank Vicky and Honorable Justice Lokur, to be here today with us to discuss such an important topic. And we are going to spread this message today on cybercrime and how it's rising, and the online safety in this workspace that we're working from home scenario in the lockdown in the COVID times. So I begin by expressing my gratitude for giving us this platform for discussion, and to the participants for joining in today. So we are all experiencing unprecedented times. You'll agree with us that COVID-19 has shaken us to the core in every aspect, whether it's public health, safety, or managing our businesses, managing our lifestyle. It's a challenge. We have to come up and as together fight this disease, which is there in the society today, in the world, affecting globally. And we are aware that there are almost more than 5,000 cases of corona in India at the moment. Lockdown is likely to be extended in many parts of India. And people, while we are all working from home, there is increased use of mobile phones, internet, and leading to, I would say, a very steep increase in cyber crimes. You'd be shocked, but the figures are absolutely unbelievable. 86% rise in cyber crimes in the last 4 weeks, and that is something which it was something that is so imminent that we have to have such webinars and such discussions. And thank for the technology today that we are able to do it in such a way. The digital safety is thus imperative in present times. Not only is our physical safety important, but the challenge today is also how to ensure we are virtually safe. So this slide takes me to the current scenario in cybercrime landscape. 86% rise as per the MHA reports, Ministry of Home, and various kinds of frauds. Various kinds. We'll be covering a few of these important ones. If you see this, the slide in Maharashtra itself, 25% spike in 2 weeks' time. And what is the main modus operandi of criminals? Social engineering attacks, fake apps, fake testing kits, fake vaccines, links which are phishing links, and fake goods being sold, fake mobile recharge, fake Netflix subscriptions, and so on and so forth. So this is what is quite alarming, and we need to be very, very cautious and careful of these things. The NCRB data, if we go back, and see what is the current, the latest data which NCRB has, data statistics for 2017, they have highlighted that the cyber crimes in the country have risen, almost doubled, from what we had in 2016. And the main motive is fraud, then seconded by sexual exploitation and defamation actions. So what the criminals today are doing, they are exploiting the vulnerabilities, not only of the crisis, of the situation of people and their mindsets, but also the security loopholes in systems, software, and the whole paradigm. How many companies are really robust enough to withstand this kind of an unprecedented crisis is a question. And therefore we're talking now of incident response, we're talking of business resilience, and that's important today as never before. Now if we see this slide, it takes us to the kinds of cyber crimes. I've tried to give it in a very easy and clear way, but we'll go one by one. Ransomware attacks. Ransomware is basically hijacking of the whole system. It will be kind of encrypt all the files and lock them, and that is spread through virus attacks. If any phishing link is clicked, if any malware link is clicked, the whole system could get locked and you are not able to access it. Disruption and damage to data and hacking is second. Again, it could be caused again through opening of any harmless files. They may look like an audio file to you, but if the source is not correct, and if you feel this not genuine and you suspect there is something wrong, we really need to not click on those links. Malware attacks, many of them are percolating today on the net. Malware is again virus and trojans. We've seen so many bot attacks spread through downloading of files which may seem just an information about COVID, or maybe an app that you download from the web which is a fake app. Fake news is another challenge today. With a number of social media platforms connecting us, it's a boon, but at the same time, we have to use it very cautiously because it spreads fake news like fire, if not curbed or curtailed in the bud. So we have Fact Checker and other means to check that. We will be discussing some of these websites where you can actually verify the correctness of a particular news and then forward it. Phishing attacks, people garb on fake identity. It's so easy to take on a software or use a proxy server to actually go and hide a real identity and then call up or send an email pretending that it's coming from a genuine source like a bank asking you for your credentials, your credit card or your net banking passwords. We must not send out any information to anybody, especially phone calls coming as if they are coming from an authentic source. selling a product, you have to be very careful of where you're giving what information. Cheating and money loss. One of the prime motives of criminals today is to siphon off monies. And they use various techniques to do that, like these fake links. And next challenge today is, the only way we are connecting these days is through video conferencing or maybe audio, you know, talking to people. And there are, if there are not so safe networks, one could have an interception. Somebody else is hearing you, intercepting you with, without your knowing, taking away information on what is being discussed. So that is again itself a challenge. Man in the middle attacks. That's another challenge. Two corporate companies discussing and maybe e-contracting online today. If they're not careful of what email they're answering, an email address can be also changed in such a way with a small s to be added or anything, a spelling check, you know, has to be made in that email, whether it's coming from the right source, because it's very easy to create fake email IDs and have man in the middle attacks and hackers coming in. And if you pass on an information for, you know, sending any monies into your account, it could be, you know, that the hacker gives you a fake account to put the monies in. And once it's gone, it becomes very difficult to get the money back. So, you know, these are the kind of crimes, especially during the COVID times, we are facing. There are n number of other cyber crimes, but my focus today here is only on these many because they are the key problems today. So this slide very easily, I just try to, you know, encapsulate these crimes into modus operandi. What is the general underlying modus operandi or the method of committing crime in these kind of cyber crimes? So one is today, fake donation sites. People are getting calls from NGOs, which are fake links to donate monies. And that we have to be cautious of. We'll be discussing which are the authentic sites, you know, where you can actually donate, like the PM CARES Relief Fund. And you must go to that particular URL in the address bar of, you know, your system and type that out. Because if you go just on search engine and type PM Relief Fund, you don't know how many fake handles are on floating on the net today. You end up paying somewhere else. So my, you know, I would urge people to actually go into that URL and then type in that URL itself. Then phishing scams is the next we are seeing, you know, today. So the general modus operandi is to, you know, create a fake identity and then steal away people's information, either through calling them or through, you know, even by emails, for instance, or messages for that matter of fact. Malware attacks is the third way, which is by sending a virus or they're sending infected links, which will install, for example, keyloggers in their system. Now, what is a keylogger? We are all using CCTVs in our offices and homes. CCTV makes one see what is happening in a particular location and premises. Similarly, a keylogger once infects your system with a virus, which you may have gullibly downloaded from a particular link, or, you know, clicking on a link or an ebook or something which you thought is genuine, could be a keylogger and expose the systems and the activity which you are doing on your screen to the hacker. So that's sort of a malware attack. And then next comes the snooping through video conference apps, which may not have, 100% security. So it's good to have business accounts and, you know, proper checks to see there's no interception and there is no sensitive information shared on such platforms. Fake news is yet another issue we are grappling with. And it's a duty of every citizen of India, for that matter of fact. Every citizen needs to check before they forward any kind of, you know, information online, because it's creating a paranoia. It's leading to mental health issues, and people are getting scared. And there's some myths. For example, you know, eating garlic would cure COVID, or, you know, if you can't breathe, if you can't hold your breath for 10 seconds, it means you have COVID. These are the kind of fake news which are, you know, floating on the web. We will come to what measures the government is taking, what social media is doing to curb this issue, and what technologies are available today, and how we can safeguard ourselves and yet be of use to others. So we'll be discussing that during the course of this webinar. Now, this brings me to the fake donation sites. we have to donate something. We can help in the COVID crisis by going to the WHO site, for instance. This is the genuine WHO site link where one can go and, you know, donate. There's a donate button on the left. If you can see the left bottom left of the slide, there's a donate link in red. Then there is PM Relief Fund on this particular link. If you find, for example, a phishing link will be something like pmnrfs.gov.in or any other alphabet anywhere in this link. And, you know, people can get duped if they go onto a wrong link. Then we can donate on mygov.in. That's again a government portal. There has been already a case where somebody has created a fake UPI ID handle with the, you know, this incorrect ID. Instead of PM Cares at SBI, he created PM Care at SBI. And you can see in the bottom of the slide, there are so many handles of different banks, Yes Bank, HDFC Bank, UPI, ICICI, where these are all fake. So we have to be aware and tell people not to do that. There are advisories already floating on the web. You know, there are news reports that Delhi Police has launched advisories to be cautious of fake links. Yet so many colleagues are, you know, in fact, calling up. They're saying there are fake courses floating. I've got many calls over the last few weeks on various kind of, you know, links which are asking for donation for fake therapists and astrologers duping people. And, you know, it's something that is so prevalent. We have to be cautious of these things. This slide takes us to the fake phishing websites. Some of them are listed here, while there may be many others, but this is only a representative list of a few which have been reported to be fake. Then we have fake mails from WHO, you know, floating, which is, I mean, it's not a real mail, but again, asking people to give in their details. So don't address any mails because they're not writing to people individually. They are sending advisories on their official website. So if you're getting any mail from a government authority, you know, giving you a tax relief or something, it may not be genuine. Arogya Setu app. Now this is a government app. So very safely you can use this and see what is the density of COVID patients, where are they, are you in the risk area. You need to probably put your Bluetooth on when you're, you know, using that, because at that point and the Wi-Fi, you know, you have to see whether you're in that vicinity or not. And there are good advisories and helplines available through the app. You can get a lot of updated information. The Ministry of Health's website also gives us important resources we can safely consider. And then the Supreme Court of India. Now, even the Supreme Court of India has expressed its concern over the fake news issues on COVID-19. And there's been a PIL where this serious note of the same has been taken, and the court is directed social media platforms to do, you know, take up technical measures to curb this menace. So this takes us to what we can do. How do we contribute to this, you know, the whole exercise, and can we be of use to curb fake news in India? You can. You have the power. And that's the slide which takes us to the kind of, you know, fact checkers available. You can go to these sites. Even Times of India, for instance, has a fact checker column where you can see the genuine news, and they actually label it and show in the window the kind of fake news which are going on. They have verified that this is fake, and they put it on the website for people to come and see. So there is a importance of doing, you know, adopting this practice, especially in these times. This is another technology. I recently read this paper and by Truth Share, which talks about, you know, detecting fake news through zero knowledge proof model. You can actually go into this link later and, you know, read up more on this technology. But essentially what it does is that if any originator is posting any information on any social media platform, this news and the content as well as the originator can be traced through this technology. I would like to also mention the photo DNA technology, which stops images which are fake from duplication on the net, whether it is a fake newspaper article or a fake video or a fake, you can actually detect and stop it on social media platforms through deployment of DNA, photo DNA hash mechanisms. Certain, our Computer Emergency Response Team of India has issued several advisories in the past few days. And you can have a look at this particular website of theirs for these various advisories available by the ministry, and including safety practices and adopting any kind of video conferencing is also there. There are advisories on how you can safeguard yourselves in terms of cybersecurity, the caution on what UPI handles are fake, use of video conferencing apps, and so on and so forth. You can actually go and see the details of this on their website. DSCI similarly, has expressly prepared certain advisories to do with, working from home environment specifically, what IT admins need to do, what employees need to do, what hospitals need to do. There are some good information and ebooks available. And social media, apart from the government, social media is cooperating with the government and in its own through self-regulation practices, trying to curb fake news through fact checkers, adoption of AI, for instance. I know Facebook has read somewhere used Roberta technology, and they're also introducing community health features and talking about business resilience groups, which is a good sign because it empowers every business connected through these social media platforms to actually find useful information and collaborate in these pressing times. Then you have best practices for online safety in COVID times. I think this section is probably of great value. If you can deploy some of these measures, it will save you a lot of problem. Lot of cyber crimes are averted. Lot of people are saved. They will not lose data, the businesses will function seamlessly. And the relevance of this slide, I cannot understate it. It is important. So we need to definitely, first of all, use robust Wi-Fi. As still a lot of people are using WEP, which is old technology. We need to shift to WPA. So I was saying that the terms of use, of a particular service is also very important for us to read. The other day I was downloading an app which asked us to basically, allow access to photographs and camera and, a lot of other, devices which are the features of a phone which are not really necessary. So it's important for us to read the terms of use, very, very important. And the digital signatures, for example. Now that's something which we can really use for, encryption. It will basically encrypt the entire content as well as the originator and the destination person. So the whole channel, the originator and the whole destination and the main particular the data integrity is maintained in that particular process, and whoever you are intending would receive this information would actually receive it. Then comes the two-factor authentication. A lot of us have been using it, OTP verification process, apart from your general passwords. And that's very useful to have. Plus, HTTPS sites only to be used, for any kind of payment. There's a lock which comes on the top, on the left-hand side. When you see a safe, secure socket layered, HTTPS website, only there you must pay for any kind of, purchase or transaction. Then this takes us to the, this other slide, which talks about the best practices from work from home. So a lot of organizations may not have the home policy or the IT policy in place. The work from home policy itself now is kind of very important for us to have. Plus, a lot of times, companies may not have deployed the VPN services. Now, what is a VPN really? A virtual private network. So we will explain this, but in a nutshell, a VPN will basically encrypt a particular, origination of a particular content from a particular system, and the IP address will be, concealed. The IP address will be concealed, and the public network will not be able to, you know, people from the public network will not be able to access the VPN unless you have an authentication and an access mode. You will not be able to see that. So the messages go in an encrypted way. They hide the real identity of the sender. That is the advantage of a VPN. Then data loss prevention software. When we use data loss prevention software, it helps us curtail loss of data on various levels. This could be the endpoint from where you're sending a data. It could be on email, prevention of loss on email or on the network itself. So at various levels, you will be sent a real-time alert. If you have a policy of data loss prevention and you're using a software, it will raise an alert the moment there is a data loss. Then comes the sensitive systems and data. They also should be restricted in access. So not everybody and not all employees will really need to know or have access to sensitive applications or data. So we have to have that policy also in place. And crisis management and incident response. This is also very, very important. Then also it's important to see that there is a periodic audit, done in a particular organization for security purposes. And when we're doing the audits, it's important for us to see if there is any kind of glitch in terms of security or any kind of, glitch in terms of hardware or software security. Then password managers, they are very, very helpful. If you can use a password manager also, that's really helpful to safeguard, all kinds of different passwords that you may have across various platforms and devices. So it will encrypt and give you only a single password to use. With that single password, you can actually safeguard, you don't have to learn, and it can be encrypted and kept on your system or on the cloud. One single password you will need to remember, and the rest work will be done by the password manager. Then regular backups of data, we need to obviously maintain as a best practice and keep the emergency incident response active at all times. So now this takes us to the PKI mode, the public key cryptography mode. Basically, it's important to use digital signatures. Digital signatures are a foolproof way. In fact, they're the best possible technology available to encrypt or safeguard a message. And you can actually sign contracts online using digital signatures, and law provides, your IT Act itself, the Evidence Act, recognizes that legally, these signatures as legally valid. You don't need to have a hard copy signed contract. You can actually have an e-contract signed it digitally and send it across. And there's a presumption in law, that this is authentic evidence, and unless the presumption is rebutted by some evidence, in support. Then we have already got in our systems built-in encryptions in both Apple and, you can see in Microsoft. So this also is a feature which we can use. They're also already inbuilt a lot of times in our systems. We may not have activated the feature, or it may be in a default mode. You'll have to look at this aspect on your machines. And yes, it's very important to have security awareness trainings. Without that, we will not be able to function in post-COVID times, at least, So this takes us to how the VPN works. This is an interesting slide which we found to explain this. Again, what is shown in the slide is encryption is happening, and the entire passage, the data is maintained, integrity is maintained, and one is able to, avoid a lot of attempts of cyber attacks through usage of a VPN. How the DLP works. Now that slide which I was showing, it's basically stepwise showing how the DLP works. So if there is a sensitive information you're sending across through a platform, for example, an email service, this DLP software scans it. It will help check the document for any kind of policy violations, whether this data is too sensitive, whether somebody is authorized to send it out, who is it being sent out to. And if there's a violation, it red flags it. So that's how DLP works. And it works at various levels. You will see then in the next slide how it happens. This is a storage point. endpoint and also at the point of network. So while you're storing it, for example, if you're storing it in a cloud or on your machine, endpoint is where you are actually using it from. You know, it's you can actually see the machine is safeguarded in terms of any kind of, you know, leakages in terms of data. And then also during the usage of the network, if there is any kind of you know, interception, that is avoided through the DLP prevention software. Lot of times people are using public cloud, private cloud, or a hybrid cloud. Now security in a cloud is also many facets now. It's not so simple as it used to sound earlier when it was just introduced. Why? Because it's layered. There is application security, the softwares and the applications you're using. There is file storage security. Then there is a conformity, network security, workload security, and then container security. So malwares are quarantined, and you know, you're also trying to use a particular application. Then the secure access is given, double authentication checks are there. That's how the cloud platforms are evolving today with more and more features. They're producing some of the very good names like Azure. They're providing good services in this domain. Now this takes us to this interesting slide, which was a 16 step, you know, on safeguarding your organization. N number of points to be looked into, for example, right from web hosting and domain name management, whether you have a secure domain, then the email system security, the multi-factor authentication and filtering, encryption usage of that, backups are being taken, the gateway security, local network controls, then user access controls, and a lot of times threat analysis, endpoint protection, mobile device management, IT, internal IT audit practices, training and education, and the vulnerability scanning, GDPR and legal law compliance, that is the IT law compliance. So there are various steps. So this whole ecosystem is evolving. And I think today we have 16 steps here. I'm sure by within a month or two, we'll have a lot of business resilience practices and more of IT incident response steps added in by post-COVID period. There are some good useful resources, which you can also see. We have on our website also some online safety tips, which is by FireNGO. And there are also some interesting you know, tips on our SAIT Associates portal, where especially to do with data protection and privacy, you can also look at that. There's an app which is available, IT Act and Cyber Law, which we had developed, and we are in the process of updating this app. It's right now on Apple, but also a new version on Android is going to be available soon. Then there are other useful resources which you can right now see, one of them being DSCI, the InfoSec Awareness platform. And this brings me to the IT Act. Now, this is an important slide. Why? Because a lot of times people say, okay, we don't know what law is there. How do we, how are we protected really? Is there a protection mechanism of data protection, even though PDP is still under, you know, under process? There is. There is a law, and that's a special law, which is the IT Act 2000. So in case of any kind of unauthorized intrusions or any damages to data or to a particular hardware, or you know, business disruptions, if it's unauthorized, fraudulent, there is an offense you know, for this particular act, and that is under section 66 of the IT Act, punishable by about 3 years of imprisonment and fine. Similarly, we have other provisions punishing for identity theft, cheating by impersonation, cyber terrorism, cheating in IPC. And while we have the PDP bill under play like now in the discussion, nevertheless, the Honorable Justice K.S. Puttaswamy case, you know, this on by the Honorable Supreme Court, 9 judgment, has already very categorically, you know, affirmed that this is a right to privacy, is a fundamental right of every citizen of India. And while we have this PDP bill, it will soon take shape. And there will be more stringent protection mechanisms. One of them, very important ones, being that there has to be an explicit consent taken from every consumer that you're taking data from. So right now, I know the main comment which comes is that we can't read such a long terms of use which is there on every website. How do we know what all we are giving away and what all rights are we giving away? Now, to that end, we have to be sure that what is to be done in the such a scenario is that with the new PDP bill, they will have to take us express and clear and clarified consent from us. They have to do it conspicuously. You know, cannot be done without that. And there are infrastructure and mechanisms and legal mechanisms being set up to protect one's interest from both intrusion by anybody. In fact, it also applies to government. It also applies to private entities. Now, this takes us to the very important aspect of evidence, electronic evidence. So if there is supposedly a particular crime, we have to keep the screenshots of the evidence and report it to the bank immediately if it's a relation to a particular account or a plastic money fraud. Blocking credit cards and debit cards is very important. On a phone call, you can actually go into a helpline and do that. And if a bank server is hacked, again, there is a zero liability for a customer. So he can report this particular attack and be compensated for it. To register the complaint to police, there's a national portal. Especially in COVID times, you can use this online. You can do it from home. It's called cybercrime.gov.in. And there's a nationwide helpline called 112, which is important. So this is the National Cybercrime Reporting Portal, cybercrime.gov.in, which you can use, you know, to report crimes. And this takes me, you know, to a particular thought which I just shared yesterday with the Honorable Justice Lokur, that it's no more only privacy by design, but COVID has transformed businesses to a default code of security by design. So while I was discussing, this is something that will be the order of the day now, the state of the art, and we need to maintain this security practices. It's very important. We all embrace this new change, transformation. While safety and health is important, we also understand the relevance and of having, you know, our virtual, I would say, identity and our virtual, activity safeguarded. With this, I think we're over to Sumit.
Thank you, Dr. Seth. I think that was very, very comprehensive and very educative. And I'm sure our participants would have definitely benefited out of that. And I'm sure there would be a lot of queries and some of the questions they would like to ask from you. I think we can take the questions after the special address of Justice Lokur. So, So I request you to unshare the screen. And it's my honor to invite Honorable Justice Lokur to deliver his special address. And thank you so much once again, sir, for kindly joining us. We look forward to your address, sir.
Thank you, Sumit. And thank you to Fiki for giving me this opportunity of sharing some thoughts. And of course, Dr. Karnika Seth, I think she has given a very comprehensive presentation dealing with various issues. Some of them I was not even aware of, frankly. So it's really been a great learning process. I would like to just share a few thoughts on two aspects. One is the subject that we are discussing, namely work from home. And the second is, what do I, as an individual, I mean, I'm not working from home or anything, but what do I, as an individual, have to be careful about when I'm on the internet? So, these are the two things. The second part has got nothing to do with work at home. Now, when you're working from home, I think the first thing that you have to be sure about is that you have to be very, very careful about what you are doing. Privacy is a very major concern. And for somebody to get into your system is not very difficult. We experienced that today, when suddenly those lines began coming on the slides. I don't know how it happened, but it happened. There could be a, you know, some problem with the system, or there could be some other problem. But you know, something unexpected can always take place. So you have to be very careful when you're dealing with official work, and you know, make sure that you're not disclosing anything that you should not ordinarily be disclosing to somebody. In the United States, for example, you know, when you are given a computer for working for the office, you can't use that for private emails or for private work. Similarly, if you have your own private, you know, laptop or a desktop, you can't use it for official work because of this security problem. And you may recall that when Hillary Clinton was, you know, standing for president, this is one of the issues that came up, because they said that you're using your official computer for private emails. So one has to be very, very careful in doing this. Not only from the point of view of somebody trying to get hold of your material, but also from the point of view of maintaining privacy of information and confidentiality. The second thing on this is that, you know, there can be a loss of data, something which Karnika had mentioned. How do you protect that if you're working from home? If you're working in the office itself, of course, there are you know, different issues. But if you're working from home and there is some information that you want to store, I would recommend that you think of using a simple, you know, external hard drive. I think that is one method of, you know, ensuring that your data doesn't get lost. We hear about computers crashing, you know. It could be because of a variety of reasons that a computer might crash. And then what do you do? You know, you'll probably go to an expert to have it repaired, and he may or may not be able to save your data. So just to be careful, because you're dealing with official work, it might be a good idea if you, you know, have a external hard disk and store your whatever information that you want. So that even if somebody by chance, you know, gets into your computer, at least he will not be able to get that information. The third thing that I would like to, you know, caution you about is that when you are in your office, I'm assuming your office provides firewalls, which you don't have at home. You know, it's not everybody just can't, you know, have a firewall installed. So that is one thing, again, that you have to be very careful about. You're very vulnerable when you're working from home, and you can find that happening, you know, time and again. Suddenly, you know, when you're looking at a particular site, you know, you'll get information about something else that you had looked at much earlier. How is it that people know about these things? So I think you have to be very careful about that as well. So these are the three things that I would you know, caution you about. One is, you know, to be very, very careful in terms of privacy, in terms of confidentiality. Secondly, storing your data, preferably on an external hard drive, so that even if there's, you know, data loss because of your computer crashing or for some other reason, you're not badly affected. And third, I think you have to remember that you don't have a firewall at home. The second thing is, you know, what do I do as a person? I mean, I'm now speaking as an individual. Phishing, of course, Karnika has mentioned about it. It's a huge problem. You will get, you know, somebody asking you for information, and you don't know whether it's genuine or whether it's not genuine. What do you do? You know, I will share with you two experiences. One is that, you know, last year I had gone for a conference, Commonwealth Lawyers Conference, and my wife was to accompany me. Both of us were to go together. So I wanted a visa for that country. I applied for a visa. I went to the website of that embassy to find out what are the documents that they require. And one of the things that came out, it was not on the official website, you know, which is a mistake that I made. But one of the things that came out was that you can apply for a visa online. So I said, very good. You know, I mean, I don't have to go to the embassy to get a visa. And I filled in all those particulars. They wanted, you know, a copy of the passport, hotel booking, air tickets, and so on and so forth. I gave them all that information. And they said, all right, your documents have been received. Everything is in order. The visa fee is so much. So kindly transfer that visa fee. Fortunately, it was not very much. So I transferred that visa fee. And they then sent me a message saying that we are processing your application. And after about a day or so, I got a message from them saying that, you know, there's a problem with the hotel booking. Now, I had booked one room. My wife and I were going to share that room. So they said that the booking document that you have presented on behalf of your wife is correct, but the booking document that you have presented on your behalf is incorrect. So, you know, I was wondering, I said, how is that possible? It's the same document. How is it valid for her and not valid for me? That's when I realized that there was a bit of a problem, you know, but by that time the money had been transferred, so there was nothing I could do about it. I went then to the embassy and I told them that, you know, this is what has happened. They said, yes, we've received complaints about this. We've told the police, but nothing seems to have happened. So, you know, now everything looked to be very genuine as far as I was concerned. And the embassy also said that we are aware of it and we have lodged a complaint with the police, but, you know, no steps were taken. All that I did was that, you know, several other colleagues who were going for that conference, I just sent them a SMS saying that, listen, please don't try to get your visa online because there's a scam in this. The second incident is, you know, a former Chief Justice of India. It happened again last year. He got a message from a retired judge of the Supreme Court saying that he's stuck in London. You know, he's run out of money, and it's a very, very common thing. He's run out of money, and can you please transfer some amount? So this former Chief Justice transferred 50,000 rupees in the account of that person. And, you know, that was the end of it. Maybe after about 20, 25 days or 1 month or something, they met. And the former Chief Justice thought that, you know, this judge will at least thank me for giving that 50,000 rupees. But that judge did not mention anything about it, you know. So he also thought very strange, you know, he's not even thanked me for giving him that money. So second time he met him again after about a month or so, he said, listen, I had sent you 50,000 rupees, you know, you had got stuck. What happened? How did you get stuck? So he said, where did I get stuck? So he said, you had said that you, I got an email that you were stuck in London. He said, I haven't been to London. You know, so everything was perfectly okay. But the judge was out, the former Chief Justice was out by 50,000. So when you have, you know, these kind of sites which asking you, which ask you for money, PM Cares, for example, you know, you have to be very careful. You don't know, you can't find out sometimes. You can't find out whether the site is genuine or it is not genuine. How do you find that out? I mean, it doesn't say that, you know, it's genuine or it's not genuine. Maybe, you know, if there's an alphabet extra or something, you might overlook it. I would suggest that in a situation like that, you know, make a donation of 1 rupee or 5 rupees. So that if something goes wrong, you know, you're not down by a couple of thousand. And if the site is genuine, fine, it's okay, it's genuine, then maybe you can give whatever you want to do. But if it's not genuine, you know, you get to know with your, and probably you would have lost only 5 rupees or 10 rupees or whatever small amount it is. So you have to be very, very careful. You know, you'll get messages from all kinds of people asking you for information. That, yes, I saw this, I saw that, and, you know, I want to be a friend with you and so on. So again, you have to be very careful of this thing. The third thing that I would like to say in this regard is that, Kandika has already mentioned that the number of crimes has increased by 86%. That's a lot in terms of percentages. It's a lot. But when you're talking about 21,000 crimes in a year, that's not much. There are a very large number of crimes that take place, but people do not report it. Now, these two examples that I gave you, I was involved, what did I do? I told the embassy, and I assumed that the embassy also brought it to the notice of the police. But I did not go to the police. I think that was a mistake. I should have gone to the police and lodged an FIR. What happened to the former Chief Justice of India? He did not go to the police to lodge an FIR. So many such cases take place. Many such cyber crimes take place, but we feel that, if I lodge an FIR, probably nothing is going to happen. And I can tell you personally, I can tell you that when I was a judge in the Supreme Court, somebody had hacked my email. And I told the Registrar General of the Supreme Court, the Secretary General, I said, you lodge a complaint with the police and tell them something very minor, There was no loss of money or there was no loss of, some junk being sent or anything like that. But my computer had been hacked. So I told the Secretary General of the Supreme Court, I said, you please lodge a complaint. He did lodge a complaint. He gave me a copy of the complaint. Now, I've retired from the Supreme Court more than a year ago. Nothing has happened. So sometimes, even if you lodge a complaint, nothing will happen. But that should not deter you from lodging a complaint. You should lodge a complaint because at some point of time, maybe if the person is doing it very frequently, that person might get caught. But by your not filing a complaint, we'll encourage him. And from a small petty crime, that person can go on to do, far bigger crimes. So, these are the things that I think I just want to mention to you. Yes, I think Kandika has already dealt with a very large number of issues, very large number of crimes and safety and security measures. But yes, one has to be careful. And ultimately, I think the use of technology, the use of Zoom, for example, or Microsoft Teams or some other, system platform is going to become very common. I remember reading in one of the newspapers a few days ago that one company, 97% of their employees are doing work from home because of this, COVID lockdown. And they're actually thinking whether we should open up an office or not, because all our work is being done from home. So we'll save on transport, we'll save on people coming, this, that, and the other. But that might be an extreme example, but I think we'll have to start getting used to, this kind of technology. Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for sharing your vision and some of the examples which you quoted. That was really sort of an eye-opener for us. And you very rightly mentioned, sir, we cannot avoid technology. This is going to be the new normal kind of a thing. However, we can prepare ourselves we can be better equipped to deal with the challenges which come alongside with this, this kind of a boon. And of course, as you rightly mentioned, there is no harm in reporting. And in fact, we must go and do the reporting. That then only something positive can happen. Now, with these words, I thank both of my speakers. Thank you so much for sparing your time and sharing your respective perspectives. And I believe we'll have some questions. We can open up for questions. Gaurav, will you like to open up for the question?
Sir.
Yeah.
Maybe you can introduce one at a time. Introduce yourself and ask a question.
Sir, I'm Sushant Mandal from West Bengal, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, first of all, I want to thank ma'am for her presentation. And I'm an assistant professor of a college in West Bengal. So the main problem is that in this lockdown, we are not going to take any more classes regular basis. So we are using Zoom for video conference and WhatsApp for sharing study materials. So in some websites or some news, we are seeing that Zoom is not that much secure. So can we do that? Can we take our classes through video conference in Zoom?
So this question is to Justice Lokur.
No, ma'am. This is to Dr. Seth.
To me. Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Ma'am.
So what you would have realized by the end of the presentation is that yes, we need to use these video conferencing softwares today. And while we are using this technology, we can try our best that we keep our data secure, and we keep another device which has sensitive information. Even though antiviruses and anti-spyware may be there on your system, yet because the level of infiltration or intrusion could vary, and a system may not be robust enough to avert a particular attack, even though you have a good software. It's best to use a device which doesn't have your sensitive information on it, especially the main official data. And you can use this with an antivirus and anti-spyware on your system. You can use this video conferencing facility. I would also urge people to use paid video conferencing facility rather than a freeware, because freeware may be susceptible to more attacks. Also, it may ensure that level of security which is expected from a paid service. So it's important to see the level of security any platform is offering and what kind of terms of use are you actually agreeing before you take up the service, because there's an I agree button. When you press on the I agree button, there's a terms of service that you adhere to, signed an e-contract. So all these aspects are very important for us to consider before we start using any video conferencing facility.
Ma'am, actually, you are saying about paid service. So, the college is in a rural area. So, the paid service is either maybe available to the teachers, but it is not available to the students. How could they afford that? They will not be able to afford. So, it will be good for the students to use the Zoom app
In that case, you can just use a device which doesn't have sensitive information on it and try and keep your softwares up to date. Any kind of security patches have to be there. You have to update everything and try and use that, even if it's a free service that you're using. If it's only a lecture that you're transmitting to your students, I don't see a harm. As long as that platform is not sharing anything which is very, very sensitive, there shouldn't be an issue with dissemination of knowledge.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. And thank you, sir, Lokur sir, for your kind information and your lecture. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Kanika would like to share one information.
Yes.
Zoom, today only I've got a request from one of my colleagues. Now, one of his friend was using Zoom for some kind of teaching work. Now, she started getting a lot of calls on her mobile. So, I think Zoom is one of the most popular and may not be the most secure. It's again trade-off between technology and safety. And anybody is really bothered about security of Zoom, they can try something else. Maybe for the time being, Google Duo may be better, something like that. And there are many other life size, or there are many other house party, and there are many other apps. All may be equally safe or equally insecure. So as you rightly said, I think if they are using with a safe device and without much of data, they don't have much to steal. But the number remains the worry, because this lady start getting call, fake call. So there's some problem somewhere with Zoom.
I think our law enforcement needs to really gear up, because myself, I've trained lakhs of police officers by now, but then even the basic infrastructure and the cyber crime units that we have across India, and their incident, you know, response in terms of any emergency. Though we have the helpline also, as I said, 112, but we really need to have this virtual e-task force in order now, because a number of crimes are happening. Anybody who's using any such softwares will be probably prone to attack till we, you know, grapple with the situation and we've taken stock of it. A lot of reporting would happen. A lot of investigation would be required using sophisticated tools to find out from where a particular attack is happening. CDRs may be available for assessing where a mobile call is coming from. So a lot of data is usually on platforms. Even a phone number, for instance, will be on social media of a particular person. So it's not that only video conferences, conferencing is making one prone to attacks. That's only an addition in the box, you see. But then one has to be aware that there are remedies. And unless we take action, we cannot forego the entire medium, because technology is here to stay. And we should be able to tackle these issues in the transition period that we are going through with proper law enforcement mechanisms in place, and maybe fast track court set up to, you know, hear cybercrime matters. Prosecution will also, you know, be expedited. We are hoping to work on the legal framework and enforcement in a more robust manner now.
We can take the next question.
Yes, next question, Sumit.
Good evening, ma'am. This is Arindam Bakshi here, ma'am, from Chandigarh University. Ma'am, I had a question. Ma'am, which is more safe, Skype or Zoom for video conferencing?
It's almost the same question that you've asked me. There's nothing ma'am, proof. Whenever there's technology, you cannot guarantee 100% safety, but yes, a lot of technological tools are available, softwares are available. And using encryption or otherwise, when can, or VPN, for instance, we can really help in curtailing these crimes and glitches. So, ma'am,
what is the best precaution that we can take to protect our data from getting breached?
I think, as Honorable Justice Nokur has also mentioned, that you keep an external hard drive, you know, that's going to safeguard your sensitive data. We should not be using the same device to do these video conference calls, through freeware, which will put your, data at risk. So that's the best way one can, proceed with it, even if you don't want to go for a paid version. And the other 16 steps which I mentioned, during our presentation, they're all equally important. But not all of them can be undertaken by people sitting at home at times, especially in these days. So whatever best you can do to safeguard yourselves, purchase genuine software online. Maybe you can deploy those at least in the current time.
May I speak, madam?
Yes.
Hello. Ma'am, I'm from Shruti Banerjee from Kolkata. Madam, all of you know that fake news is the most important and most problematic thing in this time. So what are the easiest way we can prevent or we can search which news is fake or not?
Okay, so there was one slide or two, we were when we were discussing the fake news issue, there were a few, one or two slides which focused on that issue. That when you go to fact checker, for example, you can actually check up whether this news is fake or not. There is a very interesting video of factchecker.org on YouTube also, which you can see how to detect manipulated or doctored videos or morphed images. If you find anything which is missing in a news, or you feel this is a misrepresentation, or if you feel the picture is hazy and it's moving slow, any kind of signs which put a suspicion on the source and the genuineness of the particular clip, you need to go and check authentic websites like the official websites of newspapers or PIB, for instance, to check the genuineness of a particular news. And I must let you know that if you're transferring, forwarding fake news without realizing this is fake, it could land you in trouble, because forwarding of fake news is also something which is criminally, you can be liable, especially if you've done it intentionally, only which you have to avoid this anti-religious, for instance. You should not be forwarding, especially in COVID times. We've come across a lot of apps which are circulating anti-religious, anti-communal content, which per se is illegal. So please, refrain from doing that.
Okay, thank you, madam.
Before we take next questions, can I request those who are not asking questions to keep their microphone on the mute silent mode, because there's a lot of noise coming. So,
yes. I'm Colonel Vipin from Orion Security, ma'am. Thanks for the quite exhaustive presentation, and Lucas sir also. Ma'am, this question is actually for you. You had mentioned about one zero knowledge proof model about one site, and in that you categorically pointed out that that has a capability to trace back a fake service or a fake news or a fake video. I mean, does it go to the originator, or where does it go actually? I mean, how back?
There's a detailed paper of that. I shared a link of that on the slide. I think Fiki can forward you these slides to for reference. But what essentially this technology claims is that it can encrypt any kind of information and the data which is being transmitted with the footprint of the originator's identity through the hashing process. So through the hash mechanism, it encapsulates, it involves like in an envelope in a protected manner, it transports this particular information to the second user or third user to whom it is forwarded. And one can trace back the footprint of the originator who sent or who's posted that particular link. So the geolocation data, the identity can be tracked, and the data the way a hash mechanism works, a unique print is, footprint is there, which you can actually verify that it was the same person. So much needs to be done on this. TruthShare is the, service provider in this regard, but you can look at it more. I think they would start being deployed very soon. These technologies are much in demand, and I hope that we'll be able to curb this issue with the use of these new technologies. Another technology which I want to mention is the AI. This AI is growing at this point in times of big data. Data science is being used, to create such transformers or such, data science models through which we are able to use robotics, and we are able to use AI to, detect fake news, even combine it with neural linguistic learning. So if there is a particular language which is there, if a particular community is spreading, for example, a particular group is spreading fake news, there is a particular syntax, the way in which they write those news items, it will study and analyze that AI through AI, the neuro-linguistic or the stance, the way they are using the language, and detect that this is coming from an X group and try and curb it. So this AI can huge, help us in a huge way. So we are hoping that these technologies will pave our way for the future that we envision at this point.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Dr. Seth, somebody just sent a question on the chat, which I'll just read it out. Says is there any time limit to report a cybercrime?
So the earlier the better. You can just file an FIR, sitting from your home with a click of a mouse today. So the best, the earliest time that you come to know of a crime has happened and you are a victim of a crime or you suffered a crime, immediately just report to it. There is a 100 phone number. There's a 112 phone number for a helpline. So that is also available for people to use. Another crime which is very, very prevalent at this point is that I've heard that QR code scanning crimes are happening. So for example, on an auction site, there is a particular goods or a particular item which has been put up for sale. The calls come to the person who is going to sell it, and the call will be a wishing call, where the criminal will say that I want to purchase this from your for example, if it's a dental chair or a dental equipment, I want to purchase that. You have posted an ad on this site. I want to purchase it. So you please share the QR code of your payment app with me. For example, it could be any payment app. I would not name a particular one, but yes, when they share, when this man shares his QR code, he is actually giving away, a permission to the other person to debit monies, because in the screen it shows pay 25,000, for example, and he thinks that he's being paid this money. He accepts it and he doesn't realize, because the financial details are already fed in the app. It's a social engineering crime. He accepts it. The moment he accepts it, 25,000 instead of going into his account are debited from his account. So please be aware. This is also a way in which these crimes are happening. And over the last 1 month, more than 20-25 people have been duped in our region, NCR, of the same, in the same modus operandi. And this man who calls up is generally, he represents himself to be from a armed Navy Air Force, community. So people have that psychological, impression of trust created the moment he says, I'm an ex-army officer or an ex-so-and-so and I need this help or I need to buy this from you. So please be cautioned of these crimes.
Hello.
Yes.
I just have one question. This is Lakshay Sani from Delhi.
Yes, Lakshay.
I have one question that, see, we have mobile banking applications also on our phone.
Yeah.
So is it safe, to save our data, in the sense the card details, debit card details or other card details, for future purposes? Because they do ask us, do you want to save this information for future transactions or everything? So we sometimes say yes. So it saves all our data. Is it okay to store all the data?
Well, Lakshay, it's basically the particular app that you're using. If it safeguards that information in an encrypted manner, it can be on your phone, it can be on the cloud or on the server. We need to see where this is really there. But if it is there on the cloud, if it's a good paid service and you feel it's reliable, you can continue to use that. However, I personally feel that we should not be saving them on the handsets. Also, because very frequently we lose our, one could lose a phone, right. One could lose a device and forget a device at a particular place, and it's so many times it has happened. And if you've actually saved them, the passwords on that, it's very difficult because the criminal gets access to that without knowing the passwords. So I would discourage that. Each time I have to make a recharge of my phone, for instance, I don't have that saved on. There is an option which, you put in fresh. Yes, yes, Lakshay. Yeah.
Okay.
Ma'am, similarly, I would like to ask. Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Hi, this is Ria from Hyderabad. I am basically a technical professional, but I really want to ask one question to people who are not, much aware of IT terms, and they are not much aware of, not maybe from IT background. So a very basic question: while downloading any of the application on the laptop or on mobile, how one can, identify that this application is very secure and this will not harm the mobile? Because previously, of the news on various application came, like it will, hack your mobile data or various information from your mobile. So how one can identify on a ground level?
See, if you are using an Android-based app or you're using an Apple-based platform app, you need to see if it's verified by the platform, it has some level of trust at least, rather than just going to a particular website which floats on the web and, signing up for a service. It's definitely better. You must read consumer reviews, because they also help out in checking whether any other person has used this product and is or not facing a problem. That also helps. And many times, I would urge you to read the terms and conditions, to get familiarized with the terms that are there. In these terms and conditions, there are also useful tools available. For instance, this app which I mentioned, which is IT Act and Cyber Law, has a glossary of items, words to understand what this really means. There are some books also. We have also authored a few books I've written, where you can get the glossary of technical terms and legal terms both. So you can have access to that. Perhaps you can send us an email and I will send you the resource list for you to, you know, which one or two things which you can find very useful. And I think that should be enough for you to safely, you know, take on any particular application or service from the web.
Sure. Thank you.
I have a question, Dr. Seth.
Yeah.
Hi, good afternoon, Dr. Seth. Thank you so much for your presentation. I have a question with regards to an incident which happened to a colleague of mine. He had taken a FASTag account, which is being taken by a lot of people. In fact, my husband, who's a doctor, he also was planning to take one approximately a month back. Meanwhile, my colleague told me that one fine day he was getting messages saying that he was crossing a toll when he was nowhere near a toll. And then it started happening like every in a day. It was like taking up around 4-5 times. And this is just before the COVID-19 thing was starting off. And by the time he started calling them up and everything, telling the FASTag people, so there was this thing with the Paytm. It was linked to that. So he was not able to get anybody to stop that thing from happening. And already the money is continuously getting debited. So now, isn't this also a cybercrime related thing? I mean, I because I think it's already been there in the papers, but I just wanted a confirmation because I've stopped my husband from taking a FASTag account. Thank you.
Okay, so if you're using such a account and you're facing a problem on any platform, I would say immediately you need to report it to the public grievance officer of that particular platform. And they should be able to block this activity from your end, or create a new account if they need to, you know, for you to safely use it. If they haven't used it, if they haven't done the needful, then yes, you need to anyways report it to the police, so that, you know, many people like similar to in your position would be duped this way. And if the monies are getting debited, it will be ultimately linked to is it linked to a bank account, this particular account that you're saying? If that is the case, then the banks also need to be informed immediately. And also any kind of, I would say ombudsman scheme is available. The banking ombudsman needs to, would look into this case. And if you give a complaint, even the RBI takes action if a bank is not listening, to particular grievances of a public and consumer. So there are various levels in which you can get legal redress. In the IT Act also, there is an adjudicating authority under Section 43-46 of our IT Act, where this court will grant you compensation if you are not being negligent and there has been a debit unauthorizedly made into your account. So legal framework is in place. There are enforcement mechanisms in place. The need is to spread awareness. And as Justice, Honorable Justice Madhu just mentioned, that we need to report. If you don't report, we don't expect anything to get legal recourse available to you. So report it and take action. If that particular agency doesn't take action, then you go to a higher authority and report. That's how we must pursue it aggressively.
Ma'am, how are the transactions done between the user and the hacker? If Bitcoins are banned virtually, how are the transactions done between the hacker and the user?
Now, Bitcoins, there's a latest news on Bitcoins. Yeah, I think you would be aware. It's said, now earlier it was gray area. Now it's been said to be legal. So how the transactions happen is something, beyond the scope of this webinar. But nevertheless, in Bitcoins, it's in an encrypted, ledgered manner, which safeguards, the people who form the chain. And through blockchain, it will enable, the persons to know who have transacted in the whole chain and what is being, bought and sold in terms of Bitcoins. That is also cataloged. So it is enabled through these blockchain technologies, and it's quite safe, works on encryption and cryptography. We can discuss this more in detail. Maybe when you send me an email, I can explain you this better.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Kanika, may I, Bharat Sahani here, B.B. Sahani.
Yes.
Since I'm a lawyer and I do not have an elaborate business setup, and I found the presentation very informative and exhaustive, but that kind of security network may not be possible for an individual lawyer working from home. Like at the present time, with COVID-19, many lawyers have to deliver their services online to their clients. for a lawyer, individual lawyer who cannot have his PVN, etc., etc., what would be the simple way or simple three or four things they can do to safeguard their data and whatever they work they put on, professional work on their computer?
Okay.
Without getting into
Yes. So thank you. I think
just everybody, simple tip.
Yes. Everybody here, including my colleagues, my family here. So thank you for this question. Although I would be able to explain this in more detail later, but then yes, pertinent question. Three, 4 points. One is to have a good antivirus and you know, a good spyware installed on your system. And secondly, you need to have a good Wi-Fi, robust Wi-Fi technology. Third is the caution that we would be able to read the terms and conditions, because a number of times there are, you know, people who tried to save, for example, their you know, personal pictures onto a web-based service without realizing they haven't chosen that, you know, the default app option is enabled, and they haven't chosen only viewing for myself mode. So that you know, the how to use a service is also something very, very important. And fourth is not to share personal information anywhere which is sensitive, especially financial data or other personal sensitive data, with anybody, whether it's over a call or an email. I would say that one needs to avoid, because there are a lot of social engineering, you know, traps these days, especially on social media. So these are four key steps. I think they should safeguard you to a lot of extent, and I think we'll spread this message across.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hello, ma'am. I'm Rohan Agarkar from Vadodara. I study in class 11. Ma'am, actually, I want to know about what is the difference between dark web and a normal surface web.
Okay. So what we see in the current, you know, online, when we go to the internet, is actually, you know, a tip of the iceberg, because there's a lot of action happening in the dark web. There is a huge information and a lot of sites, especially. I was studying lately a project on wildlife cybercrime. Found it very fascinating, you know, although we are discussing, you know, crimes in the COVID times, but then these frauds are not just limited to that on the dark web, but they could be drug peddlers, they could be, you know, people selling obscene information online, and money laundering activities, and you know, selling all sorts of banned items. So hackers are prevalent in the dark web, and we need to be careful in the sense that how we reach the dark web. There are proxy servers, there are, you know, trojans available. You can conceal an identity using onion routing technology today, because through layers of onion, you have a layer after a layer, and there's an IP receiver. So through such methods on the dark web, and, you know, you can actually spoof an identity, you can hide your real identity and see what is, you know, happening in the on the web. So I think it's very important to maintain safe practice and hide your identity. Attacks if you're not.
Thank you, ma'am.
Hello, I'm Jirang. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Hello, ma'am. I'm Jirag. Actually, I'm a student. I'm doing law. Ma'am, I just wanted to ask you a question about the same question regarding dark web. We can actually access dark web. It's not a big. We can actually use a Tor browser and access dark web and all. But can we actually file a complaint against some people or maybe some pages which are on the dark web? I know it's all.
Yes. Why not you? No, you should report it. If you find something which is illegal, you must report it to the police, and they should take action based on that. There are a lot of you know, rackets, even child pornography rackets, for instance, being busted with this you know, reporting, active reporting. That is the need of the hour, because if we want to create digital hygiene, safe practices, if there is an offense happening or there's a crime, we need to report this. It's so, in fact, it should be made mandatory in a lot of heinous crimes at least.
Okay, ma'am. One more question. Ma'am, actually, we can accessing dark web is not a big deal for the current generation. So, but in most of the countries, it's actually illegal to even have a Tor browser or even try to even accessing dark web. It's illegal. You will face legal consequences, I guess. But in India, I don't think there are any certain provisions regarding this matter. Or are there any provisions?
There are. The law says that you cannot publish anything, for example, if it is obscene in nature, or if you're hacking somebody's system or unauthorizedly accessing somebody's data. Or there are other special statutes, which also talk about this issue. And there could be, sections under now PDP bill, which is, in place right now, will be enacted soon. So through various, different acts, for example, as I was mentioning wildlife, there would be a Wildlife Prohibition Act. So if there is a prohibition under any of these statutes, you can very well report it to the police. IT Act is a special law, but not all issues will be addressed there. But nevertheless, there is law in the country. Depending on the situation or the particular aspect, you can file a legal action.
Thank you, ma'am.
Sumit, are there any more questions? Or
I think I'm really sorry, but in interest of time, I think we'll have to. Because there is another webinar scheduled in another 5-10 minutes. So if I could.
I want to just thank Honorable Justice Lokur for sparing his precious time to, give us the special address, and Fiki for having given us this opportunity to address so many questions. I'm sure there are lots of them to Honorable Justice Lokur and to myself. We will be happy to answer them offline if you send us those queries. And my heartfelt gratitude and thanks to all the participants also. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Justice Lokur.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a lovely session. Very interesting.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Sumit.
Thank you so much, Dr. Singh. Thank you.
I think we should all applaud you, ma'am. So, here's a clap, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
I think it's Fiki's initiative.
Thanks for all your support, Dr. Singh.
Thank you. The IT support also, I think it was quite timely. These glitches occur, but then we have to fight them.
Will the PPT be shared? Thank you so much. Thank you, Lokesh. Thank you so much. Thank you. 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 Thank
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.